But first, I've spoken this week about the disastrous path we're headed down as state governments pursue treaties with Indigenous Australians. In the last few days, we've learned about a push in Queensland for the right to block mining projects, on top of the fact that the minister responsible has conceded treaties will cost taxpayers in that state hundreds of millions of dollars apiece. This, of course, is all a precursor to what we can expect from a voice to Parliament at a federal level too. Remember, treaties and truth-telling are both key demands of the Uluru Statement. Now, we've heard a lot about Canada and New Zealand being a benchmark for treaty negotiations, a benchmark, but not that much on the US experience with Native American tribes. Now, it seems odd to me because we all know Australia got into this habit of importing much of the US activism. So why not talk about it? So who better than help us to understand the US treaty experience than my next guest? I'm joined now by Professor Tim Lynch, political science professor and associate dean at the University of Melbourne. Tim, thank you for your time. You've written a brilliant article today in The Australian about US-style treaties. Are you surprised that the US experience isn't more prevalent in the current debate here?
Oh, good evening, Peter. Well, yes and no. I think in some ways our understanding of our own race politics here in Australia are inevitably a refraction of our understanding and misunderstanding of what's happening in the US. Perhaps I am surprised that some of the technical legal experiences of Native American sovereignty haven't formed more centrally part of the discussion we've had. They have some. But I think America is a much more complicated place with 50 states all wrestling at some degree with this issue, with a larger Native American population. So it surprises me that we don't use it, but there's some reasons to explain why it's not front and center. We rely, I think, more on the caricature of white supremacy and the history of American racism and use that more for political point scoring in the debate over The Voice than we do actually explore some of the legal mechanisms through which Native American Indians have sought to realize their rights.
Yeah, I do think it's interesting because you're right. When we talk about racial issues here in Australia, it tends to be the African American civil rights movement that's sort of imported here and not the story of the original American inhabitants. And I'm wondering why that is. But from what I can understand from your column today, I mean, much of the debate here is about, you know, doing the right thing. The Yes campaign here doesn't want to talk about the outcomes. We don't even know how this voice might be comprised, how they're going to be voted in. We don't even know what their body of work will be. We're told, give the government a blank check, they'll sort that out later. But there's different sort of responsibilities and arrangements in the US system. Give us a better understanding of what happens there.
Yeah, so I think one of the key differences are that the contention of the voice, and I'm not an expert in Indigenous politics here, but the difference with The Voice here is that it seeks a nationalized voice, and it's a national voice to Parliament. Whereas the approach of the United States across 200 years of struggle, both military struggle and then struggle with poverty, as well as pockets of great prosperity amongst Native Americans, has been conducted at the state level. I mean, the federal government has a role, but there's never been an argument that's had any legs that you need to increase the strength, the health, the coherence, the dignity of Native Americans. You need a separate branch, a body in the US Constitution. That seems to me to be a significant departure in both experiences of this issue.
So you're saying that the Native American example is more over sort of land and treaty-related, territory-related issues, whereas in Australia we're talking about decision-making, discretion, involvement in the whole process of absolutely everything that might impact Aboriginal people,
yes.
Which is
yes.
Every law, every debate, every discussion.
Yes, I think this is why I mean, one could argue both sides of this issue, but I think the Australian attempt would be regarded as a radical way of dealing with an endemic problem, much more radical than the Americans have been prepared to countenance. The US, it's got, for all its faults, it has a very stable, bicameral federal system the idea that you would add, on the basis of race, a body that can have real influence and power over the Congress and over the president, that would be to remake the US Constitution. We've come to regard, and I think there are arguments both ways, but I'm an American constitutionalist. Part of its appeal is that it changes very little over time. It doesn't embrace radical overhaul. So there is a big risk here that in trying to radically overhaul the Australian Constitution, there is no obvious model, especially when it comes to the charged issue of racial politics, of quite how to do that and what the potential consequences might be. So they're really quite different as approaches, though we here, let me suggest, think about race as a kind of monolithic in the US. There is white oppression and there is black suffering. Well, of course, at one very important level, that is the history. But the shades of grey in between those positions, I think, is something that's lost to us.